Namaste, everyone. I think let's commence the session. I think we have 40, almost 40 participants. So let's begin the session. First, right from the onset, I'm very happy to be here and talk about very interesting topic. And I'm hoping that we'll have very fruitful discussion also in between. So let me share my screen. And let me introduce the topic today. Okay, so this is the title of today's talk, that is Understanding and Predicting Human Behavior and Indic Perspective. So before we actually commence the entire thing, let me tell you what I'm going to trying to unravel today. Today we'll talk about what you mean by human mind from modern and Vedic viewpoint. The meaning of most popular psychological terms used by a layman. So I will give you meaning of those terms, because psychology is usually known by words. Those are not part of psychology fraternity as such. The human as a system, a Vedic psychological model, human emotions and levels of human experience. So these are the points I'm going to cover today. So before we dive deep into that, I have an activity for all of you. And I urge you to use the chat box for that. I have some incomplete lines and I want you to complete it. Either you can answer all or you can answer five, six, whatever you feel like. I want to see what is your concept of these words. So you can start posting your answers. While you're doing that, put the number and then your answer. So incomplete sentence. When I think about psychology, I get confused, for instance, or I get excited. So what are your responses? You can also unmute yourself and give your response. Okay. Amazed, advanced. Okay. Science of human behavior, a mix of feelings, satisfaction, contentment, fascinating, highly subjective. Okay. Understood mind. Okay. Fascinating. Science of human behavior, the application of psychology. Very nice. Oh, it's flooding. Responses, very nice. Okay, stigma, science of human mind. Okay, I think about stigmatization, philosophical profundity, manovigyan. I think about the mental state of being. Okay, amazing, advanced. Okay, complicated, too much expectations. Pain is sensation. Okay,
Could you just
I'll
project
share. Yes, sir, yes,
could you
sir.
project the questions? Keep them there.
Okay. Pain reminds us that we are alive. Okay, this is interesting. This is just a loosening exercise. So I'll come to know what are your concepts. Unpredictable. Okay. Okay. Pain is illusion of which is not. Okay. Mindset, uncontrollable, addiction, consciousness, is materialistic. Oh, we have varied responses, even philosophical, very vast. Bliss. Okay. Very nice. Okay. You can keep on adding your responses. Let's see how far you can go. And even in the course of time, in due course of time, if you want to change your answer, or if you get more clarity, you can also put there. For counseling, I talk to friends. Okay, pain is just a feeling which shall end and it's not permanent. All right. Okay, then I'll move ahead. This is the scope of psychology, actually. Let me tell you right from the onset what comes under modern psychology. So scope of psychology is this. I have divided scope of psychology into total 5 main areas. Mental processes. So modern psychology talks about what do you mean by attention? What do you mean by sensation? So sensation is a very biological term and very fundamental one. Memory is also a process, it's not some state. Consciousness, sleep, or sleep paralysis, or sleep disorders, all come under mental processes. What do you mean by thinking? Under human behavior, problem solving, decision making, interpersonal relationships, making and breaking relationships, marital relationships, close friendships, everything comes under human behavior. Then human mental states like motivation, emotion, personality is also a very famous word, and something called flow state. Then human predicaments like mental disorders, anxiety, depression, psychosomatic problems. This corona has really opened up this Pandora's box, and people now they're talking about psychosomatic incidences. For example, if someone reads in news about corona, there's a possibility they immediately start showing some symptoms and they're actually fit and fine. So this is more like psychological problem created some physiological reactions. So that's what psychosomatic in very simple word. Then personality disorders like narcissistic personality disorder or antisocial personality disorder, like I would say well-known word for layman. Then psychological interventions, psychotherapies, counseling and whatnot. So it's a vast scope. I haven't even included biological aspect of it or neurological aspect of it. But by and large, scope of psychology is mental processes, human behavior, that is what actually we do, human mental states, human problems or predicaments, and psychological intervention. So that's what the entire gamut of psychology. Now I have one question for you before even we proceed further. Why do you think psychology actually moved out from philosophy? It was initially the same thing, psychology and philosophy. So why psychology actually moved away from philosophy? Anyone can answer. Either you can unmute yourself. I will also have some human connect, or you can put Zoom group chat. There's a big debate had in Europe. They had like big debate whether psychology should be continued as separate, because it not only question, it also answers a lot of questions logically. All right. So logic aspect of it. Mm-hmm. Because you know, usually when people go to a psychology or psychologist, they have some preconceived notions. They feel like, you know, there's something wrong. Then only you go to psychology. Scattered of mind. Okay. And philosophy is something which we use or misuse most of the time. Mm-hmm. Okay. Presumption of biological boundaries. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. Philosophy is belief. Psychology is not belief. It means, okay. Psychology is also helpful in treatment in mental illnesses. Even philosophy does that, but today this is not our goal or motive. So I will not talk about it. Mm. Meaning in life. Okay. Meaning of life rather. Okay. All right. Okay. One of the reasons, let me put my view. One of the reasons why psychology moved away from philosophy is the methodology. Someone has already written a bit about that. So psychology has an impact of pure sciences in Europe. And when Renaissance took place, when logic came on surface, people started asking questions not to only religion, but the entire human system. And philosophy is more to do with speculative research. It's very difficult to prove something, or I would say it's very difficult to verify what philosophy is saying. On the contrary, psychology can actually prove things. It is more to do with biology. It is more to do with physics. It is more to do with chemistry. So psychology moved away from philosophy for one reason. And the reason was cause and effect. What causes pain? What causes happiness? What causes one person to move from A to B? With verifiable proof, empirical science impact was so much on those psychologists that they actually decided to cut the rope from philosophy and develop their own science. So this is one of the reasons why psychology moved away from philosophy. Now, why I'm telling you this? Because usually people get confused between psychology and philosophy. So this is one of the differences. Logical science, it's a more like, you know, step-by-step process. And because of that, we could progress and we could come up with proper treatment part of it. Okay. So now after this, let's talk about what do you mean by psychology. So it's a scientific study of humans' mental processes. Mental processes, I have already explained in my previous slide. What are the mental processes? Like thinking, problem solving, decision making, communication, interpersonal relationship. So it's a human mental process and behavior. Now, what do you mean by science? Now, all most of you are from like IIT and other people also using logic in their life. So when we talk about science, usually we talk about this. We do observation. After observing, we figure out the common factors. We call that abstraction. After abstraction, we classify them into different categories based on their common properties. After that, we measure them. And without measurement, control cannot happen. So if I want to measure the speed, I should develop that device. If I want to control speed, I need to measure how, what is the RPM or how human processes. So I need to measure that. Then only I can control it. For instance, if I want to work on somebody's depression with the help of, let's say, counseling, I should be able to measure how depressed that person is. And then only I can control it. I cannot just throw stone and hope for the best. So I control it. There is also scientific rigor. And then most important, can I predict how that person is going to be? In psychology, that's one of the most important goal of psychologists, predicting human behavior. Rather, we all of us, we are interested in two things. First, understanding why I behave the way I behave, or why you behave the way you behave. And second, can I predict how you will be? And prediction is very important. Then next point of psychology, it is an empirical science. What do you mean by empirical science? Empirical science is based on sensory experiences and verifiability. I can make hypothesis and I can work on it. I can either accept it or reject it. If I get this hypothesis rejected, then I rework and I put forth my truth and test it. So Karl Popper, one of the most profound empiricists, really helped psychology develop a science. As I already mentioned, influence of physics, biology, and chemistry on psychology, you can easily see that. The entire neurocognitive science coming into picture. A lot of research is going on, like where memory is, or how learning takes place, why autism is increasing, or dyslexia, or learning disabilities. So a lot of influence of biology, easily you can understand on psychology. So that's what psychology is, a science of human processes and behavior. Now then, when like very important question, where the mind is? We do talk about it like in the mind and whatnot, but where is the mind? In the heart or in the brain? Now again, I urge you to put your answers. So let me see, what do you think? Okay, how can you objectively measure extent of depression? I'll come back to that, yeah. Where the mind is, heart or brain? In the brain, okay. Independent, okay. Neither. Okay. Mind, nobody knows for sure. Neurons discovered everywhere. Okay. Motherboard of feeling. Very interesting. Okay. Mind is associated. So, associated part of brain. Okay. So, everywhere. All right. Yeah, you're right. Western psychology explains mind in very different way. First and foremost, it is an abstraction. If you put our body into scan, you know that there is no mind. You cannot actually pinpoint the volume of mind or nature of mind or structure of mind. Western psychology has no answer. Best answer Western psychology can give our mind is, which I've already written, it is a network of millions of neurons firing, sending neurochemical and neuroelectrical messages and respond to a stimulus in a fairly synchronized manner. Now, why I said fairly synchronized manner? Most of them, it is synchronized. But when you talk about depression, when you talk about anxiety, when you talk about some form of psychological disturbance, the answer is the entire communication is not happening properly. And all of you, I urge you to look at one word from this definition, to stimulus. If there is no stimulus, nothing happens. And in psychological paradigm, of Western psychological paradigm, stimulus has to be an outsider. So it is stimulus response, stimulus response. Let me now cite one experiment. I don't know how many of you know about that. It was about a dog. Ivan Pavlov was the person who was a Russian scientist, was not actually working on psychology. He was working on dog's digestive system and other physiological measures. So what he did, so he had one dog. He used to give him food, but before offering food, he used to ring a bell. Now you all know that when a bell rings, there should not be any response, or if there is a response, it's some random response, which is not actually associated with ringing the bell. Now, what he used to do? He used to ring the bell and used to give that dog food. Now, food led to salivation. So, bell, food, salivation. Bell, food, salivation. So, he paired it. After a few trials, after a few days, he actually stopped giving that dog food. He used to ring the bell and response was salivation. So he actually coined this term called classical conditioning. This is one of the reasons why we have habits. Habits are so unconsciously that they work that we don't even understand that. One of the best example, like we have association with rain. When the rainy season is going on, rain and one particular food or a particular place and emotion or a particular person and emotion or behavior. So this is how psychology actually started discussing human behavior, like a paired associations. But then later, people figured out that we are not just slaves of our stimulus response thing. We also act with our will. We have a conscious choice to do that. So that's what psychology actually progressed. So it's very interesting from, let's say, from this impulse, biological hardwire subject to now we have reached where we talk about free will, where we talk about a human's own wish and work. So that's what. So split between physical and psychological, that's the main part of it. Stimulus, according to Western psychology, has to be an external. And behaviors only which is observable. I'll connect this dot. So just hold on to these words, two words. Stimulus has to be an external, according to Western psychology, and behavior is only when it is observable. I'll move to the next. Now, what do you mean by human here? So Western psychology has distributed human into three main functions: behavior, affect, and cognition. The basic meaning of affect is emotion that all we feel. Cognition is understanding, thinking, classifying, something which I explained, science of psychology. And behavior is your motor actions. That's what behavior is at the basic level. So anything comes under psychology, you can explain with the three aspects. So when I sit for an examination, I will have an affect. If I am prepared, my affect will be either I am very confident, or I'm composed, or I'm happy. My cognition is going to be, okay, I have gone through my text. I know what kind of paper will be, and I am in control. That is my cognition. And behavior is actually writing an examination. When I form a relationship, I feel something about that person, I think something about that person, and then only I behave. So that's what human as a function, psychology explains. So depression comes under all three. Depression is feeling very low, very sad, thinking all negative. Entire life has become doomed. So that is cognition. And what behavior one person would do in depression? Either not moving from even bed. In serious cases of depression, people even can't get up from their bed. Or even if they get up, their action is very slow. And even self-destructive. So this is like one example how Western psychology has distributed human as a function at three levels. Now, I want to take this particular slide. And this is what popular meaning of these words. Anxiety means apprehension of future event. Now, this is very important. Again, anxiety cannot be there when you're thinking about past. Past has a connection with depression. It's a dejection due to the past behavior. So you have already done something. You're not happy with that. That's why you are in depression. You haven't done anything yet. You are about to do something. And if you're very, very apprehensive about the result, what that result is going to be, then you get into anxiety. One more popular word is stress. So it's a psychophysiological tension due to disproportionate ratio of challenges and resources. Simplest definition of stress is when you have more number of demands and less number of resources. When you cannot cope up with these two, then whatever that tension creates, the tension is called stress. And definitely stress, prolonged stress, can lead to anxiety and depression. Now this personality word is also highly misunderstood by layman. Personality, usually we talk about the way we look, but that's not what personality is. Personality word comes from persona. Persona is something that is in the outer, something which can be seen to people. But in psychology, personality is beyond that. It's more like an inner mechanism of or constellation of human traits. What do you mean by human traits? Traits means characteristic, like confidence or extroversion or introversion, gregariousness, neuroticism, when you have a lot of negative emotions. So these are your traits, helping nature, for instance. And traits are fairly stable. They don't change on a daily basis. This is also important thing for you all. So when you want to describe a human behavior on a consistent manner, you need to go to the traits, the characteristics which are stable across the time. They're not even changeable according to Western psychology. You cannot make an introvert person extrovert or either way around. Or you cannot make a negative person to completely positive person. That's what Western psychology would talk. But Vedic psychology has a different answer. Complete transformation is possible. And there are steps to be taken for that. So personality is like the bundle of all what we are, all our characteristics. And they determine almost all our action. So person who is an extrovert, obviously what action you can predict, they always be with people. They like people, they work with people. In your organization, for example, if you have a lot of extrovert people, you can expect good team building. On the contrary, if you have introvert people, you need to put an extra effort to make them work with others because they love their own company. One more word I chose, that is counseling. People feel counseling is just a dialogue, a friendly chat, or giving suggestions. I would say that's not completely wrong, but this is non-academic meaning. It is an empathetic dialogue between a client and a therapist or counselor. And what is the motive of counseling? That is aimed at finding solution and self-acceptance. So it is more than a friendly chat. It is non-judgmental. So these are like popular words. So before I proceed further, if you have any question at top of your mind, please ask. Is affect related to emotion? Yes. Yes, sir. Anything about this particular slide, actually, I want you to ask. Then we'll proceed further. If you have any misconceptions which you want to get clear. Can we students benefit from Vedic psychology? Of course. I haven't even started talking about that. And I'll start. First, I wanted to give you the entire Western view. Because I'm going to talk about what are the limitations of Western psychology. If you don't have any question, that's okay. Maybe towards the end, I'm going to keep some time because it's important. Personality definition is a little confusing. Okay. I'll explain. As I said, personality is not only the way you look. It is an outer part of it. For instance, you are looking at me. So what the way I have dressed, the way I have groomed. So that is one part of it. It is, in your own language, if I say, personality is your hardware, according to Western psychology, your default setting, your RAM, your motherboard, your CPU, whatever. That's what you are. And the way your processor is, output comes. So if my laptop is Celeron, that is like very old, I think 10, 15 years old computer, definitely what I'm going to, you know, work on that, nothing. So if my personality is that dormant, if my personality hardware is not that solid, whatever behavior is going to come out of that is going to be always faulty. So according to Western paradigm, personality is your system, which can be explained. That's why I chose this word. This is not the way you look, that is just tip of iceberg. That's why I said it's a human trait. Even after this conversation, we can talk about it because personality is a very deep topic. Can anxiety be overcome? Of course you can do that. Once you know why you get anxious, actually the root is there. It in expectations. We'll talk about it towards the end. I really want you to ask question. I'll be happy to answer your questions. So for the time being, I move ahead because I also have time constraint. So let me proceed further. Okay. Now, what are the limitations of Western psychology? It's very important. So definitely we are not undermining it, or we are not even saying this is like half-baked science, not at all. It's a quite robust one. And I also say why it is limited. First, we'll go through these limitations. So lack of understanding of inner processes. For instance, this Pavlov experiment I told you about the dog and the salivation. We are not like that. We also have so many inner processes which can't be seen, which can't be measured also. That's why someone has written psychology is very subjective. Yes, it is a subjective science. It is not an objective science. You can bring objectivity to a certain extent. That's what Western psychology has done it. They map the consistent pattern of human behavior. Then overemphasis on outer observation. Like something that is seen, only that I will believe. For example, thinking was ridiculed by Western psychology initially. There's no thinking. Can you show me thinking? No, then thinking does not exist. That was the behaviorist view. Now we have changed it. We can also talk about it. Then unsatisfactory understanding of nuances of human behavior. Categorization, no? Because psychology came from the entire impact of biology, physics, and chemistry. There is no in between. So black and white. These are that. That's it. That was one of the reasons why now Western psychology also moving towards Eastern, because reading between the lines, as we say in layman's language, excellent in Eastern psychology, Vedic psychology. The limited understanding of self. Who is the person? The deep, who am I? That question. Western psychology has no satisfactory answer to this. They only talk about cognition, affect, and behavior. That's it. There is no deeper understanding. Then oversimplification of human experience by making artificial categories like depression, anxiety, schizophrenia, flow, happiness, subjective well-being. They came with n number of terms or terminologies, but again, not the nuanced understanding. And last, understanding of the intervention is at nascent stage. Even today, counselors can't tell us properly why counseling worked, at what level it worked, and why it worked. They only say it worked. Person who was depressed now is not depressed. But actually what happened, that Pandora's box, that black box was not open, is not open in Western psychology. There are the limitations which can be substantiated by Eastern psychology. That like today I'm going to talk about Vedic psychology. So I have some questions. Let me take that first. Okay. Media creating anxiety these days, and you can't even escape it. Of course you can. It's completely based on where you look at and what is the process of your perception. All right then. So we'll embark the journey of Vedic psychology after establishing the Western paradigm. First concept, which I really want to introduce today, is this. In Vedic psychology, we call psychology is a science of human experience. Every moment, every action you take creates some impression on you. Now, where the impression gets formed, Western psychology has no answer to that. But Vedic psychology has. But if you want to get some experience, you should know what is the mechanism. What happens? Where it happens? Where can I have control over things? So this is one concept called antahkarana. And there are four parts of antahkarana. It is ego, that is your ahankar, chitta, that is your memory, manas, that is your mind, and buddhi is your intellect. Now let me give you one simple example. If someone is in relationship and thinking about how my relationship is going to unfold based on certain things. Let's talk about first that memory, my old association, my samskar. If I had some bitter experience, definitely I'm going to be more cautious. Now, where the cautious word comes from? It comes from your mind, and super analysis happens at intellect level. Now, first, ego. Let me clear one point here. Ego is not that pride ego. It's not about boasting. Here, ahankar doesn't mean if I have 10 cars, then I have ego, or don't hurt my ego, or don't say something to me. So that ego, I'm not talking about. Here, ego means individuality. It's a feeling of I-ness, my do. I am the doer. I am the karta. If I say, who are you, or whose pain is this? When you say, this is my pain, this is my institution, this is my vehicle, this is my life. So that my, or I do, I study, I ask, I failed. This I-ness is ego, the doer, the main individuality. Who is? That is ego. Now, chit has different meanings. Here, I have chosen this old association, whatever habits, impulses, our own experiences, all that is stored, that is we call memory. Now mind is a seat of emotion, Now you can see, look, usually when we say in Western psychology or in even in our day-to-day life, you know, you have to do with your mind or man, man se karo, man ko dard hota hai. All that thing, where that man is, a man is a seat of material for thought. It gives you material for thoughts. It has emotions and ideas. But at the same time, from where those ideas are coming from where those emotions are coming from your memories. Either you form new memories or you reactivate your old memories. When you go, for example, now though you all are in your hostel, when you go to your hometown, when you look at some tea stall or you look at your own school, what happens? Immediately all your systems, they get activated. First, my school, my college. All your memories, you get nostalgic. Now, when you get nostalgic, immediately you go to the emotion. You feel good, bad, based on your experiences. And then it go to your last, when you figure out two things separate. So this buddhi is your highest faculty. Actually, look, I have written here the ability to discern, vivechan, we call that, right, wrong, perishable, eternal. So buddhi in popular sense is intelligent quotient. So Western, the way Western psychology explains, your scholastic aptitude, that is one part of the buddhi according to antakkarana. It is your logic, your judgment, your imagination, understanding the whole thing, why I am in misery. If you want to know that, you have to challenge your intellect. You have to go to the concept of happiness or pain, or success or failure. Now you can easily understand, if you get stuck at mind level, if you're only thinking about your emotions, you won't be able to cure from that. Why? Because you are making association between mind and memory. I filled in my previous years, so this is just the byproduct of that. Or I am very consistent in that. You're not even climbing up to the intellect, which is your ability to analyze. So that's what, like in simple word, this four layers are. So any questions on that before I proceed next? Or you need, if you need more explanation, because this is like seat of everything. I'll pause for... Yeah,
one question. Where does intuition fit into this? Is that modeled by Vedic psychology at all, or
yes,
it's completely
yes.
not
intuition
there.
And one of my teacher gave me beautiful answer to this intuition. What first, if I before I answer, what is your view about intuition? What do you mean by intuition?
Intuition is something which is beyond logic, where you just know something, but you may not be able to logically explain it all the time.
Mm-hmm. Or we also call that gut feeling.
Yes.
Some, you know, very strong feeling that something's going to happen.
Correct, correct. Right? So I think the intelligence is at three levels. There is instinct, which is hardwired into the body. Mm-hmm. For example, when fire comes close, your hand will automatically move.
Yes.
It requires processing consciously.
Yes.
That is instinct. It is designed to protect you. It's called the flight and fight.
Correct.
And then there's intellect, which requires conscious processing based on past, and you analyze and project and do all that.
True.
And beyond that, whatever sometimes you just know is all the realm of intuition. I think all creativity, imagination, gut feeling, all that ability to work with the future is all there in that realm. So I'm wondering where it falls in this diagram.
Sir, actually, intuition comes under intellect only.
Okay.
The definition which I got from my teacher is, and I just love that definition. He said, intuition means supersonic intelligent process. Means you are so much in control of the situation that you could do the processing in a fraction of a second. the entire intelligence was so active. The all your mind, memory, ego, they all got synced in a such a way that you could understand that process in no time. That's why we all must have experienced this intuition, and then we wonder why we can't have intuition every day or every moment. Because either we are caught up at mind level, that is our emotions, instead of we riding emotions ride us. Or we are constantly ruminating, we are thinking about the past mistakes. Now you can easily understand person who is in depression, where the problem is. What do you think where the problem is at intellect level? Means all at every level, of course, means, you know, we can't have absence of intelligence. It's only dormant, maybe not working properly. Where the main problem of all psychological problems, anxiety, depression, personality problems, stress,
samskaras.
Suicide.
Samskaras. It appears to be from samskaras.
Mm-hmm. And where, what is missing here in depression? Why one person is in depression and X is not? So maybe...
Probably the person who is in depression identifies with those negative emotions and thinks that he is that.
Yes.
So we can't see a difference between I'm having a feeling versus I'm that feeling.
Yes.
If I'm feeling sad, then he feels his sadness itself. He can't see that I am having sadness. He just says, I am sad. So he identifies with that.
Correct. This is one of the reason. And this particular distancing your emotion from your ego is not much available in Western psychology. When you say, I am the emotion, then you cannot change something. So you have to be separate from that if you want to change it. So in depression, intellect is not functioning. In anxiety also, all psychological problems. And you're caught up with samskaras and your emotions. So, because we don't have much time for that, otherwise I could have gone into the depth of it. But that's like on superficial level, at preliminary understanding is this. So this is mechanism of our human experiences.
Yeah, I had another quick question. Yes. What about wisdom in this? Is there a role for it, or is it an abstract notion which is not there?
Wisdom, sir, as we said, it comes by practice. So I think when your intellect becomes super fine and working most of the time, in most of the situation, I would call it wisdom is that. So practicing one mechanism again and again will make that process so automated.
Is that what they call prajna?
I'm not sure about the Sanskrit word. So I'm not very confident about this particular word.
All right, no problem.
Okay.
Thanks.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, now after this, antakarana, this is also a very interesting concept of emotions. And I will present the Vedic psychological understanding of emotion. We call that bhava rasa, vichar. It is in Bharat Muni's Natya Shastra. And it's a very beautiful concept. Bhava means emotion. And rasa is not emotion, it's more than that. This is absolutely unique contribution from Vedic psychology to the entire gamut of emotion and psychotherapy. It's a beautiful concept. Bhava is the basic ingredient on which people work or function. So it's a fundamental state of being, like preliminary. So I've written some examples of that. Bhaya or Hasa, Rati, Jugupsa. These are not the ecstatic or ecstasy experiences. These are like prerequisites to experience something. So for example, if you encounter a tiger, what happens with you is the basic hardwired bhaya. I'm getting echo. Hello?
Neha Agarwal needs to mute.
Okay. No, it's fine. Yeah. So, bhaya is your base on which bhayanaka rasa experience. You get that experience. Hasa is like, you know, basic emotion which you have doesn't give you any even involuntary bodily reactions. It just like humor is there, but you are not experiencing that. So that is one base. After that, when you have other elements added, for example, let me give like simple example. When you are watching a film, and in that film, there is a Nayak and Nayika. They are in the jungle, and rain is happening, like thunder, and only both are there. So what happens? There's a lightning, and because of the lightning and the sound, Nayika gets frightened, and she embraces Nayaka. Now you're watching the play. You're watching either in film or in a theater. Now, when you get identified with that, and when you get some goosebumps, either you could get goosebumps or you some psychological and physiological reaction because of their enactment, we can call that in aesthetics rasa. Rasa is actually meant delight, an aesthetic, something that you relish, created by a creative art form. It is also a transportive experience. That's why sometimes we have tears in our eyes. Same song which you heard for like in a million times, but one day what happens, you just listen to that song and you have some psychological and physiological reactions. So that pure pristine feeling in aesthetics is called rasa, and it can take you to either to self-awareness. This is something parallel concept, just to make you understand. In Western psychology, they call that flow experience. Flow experience means if you're working on some task and just time passed, and after 1 hour, when you checked your watch, oh my God, I was doing this for 1 hour. You lost sense with the time. You lost sense with your body too. Complete pristine state of concentration and happiness. That they call flow. One person called Csikszentmihalyi from Western psychology who developed this term, but definitely he took it from Indian literature. So this bhava rasa concept, I'm just giving you the base. It's a quite deep topic. So rasa experience has a potential to open up mental faculties. It also works on therapeutic level. That's what even I am trying to work on. How can you induce a rasa and bhava in one particular person and make that person think about himself or herself, or giving them more perspective? So bhava is emotion, rasa is transported experience. So that is one interesting concept of emotion from Vedic psychology, which can be used in aesthetics and make people even enjoy that play more. So next is then how to do that. Now, so far what we have done, we talked about basic concept of antakkarana, then emotion, and now this is even more interesting. These are three levers, we call it triguna. Sometimes we are very active. We are always in action. We go here and there, we do multitasking. We want to achieve way too many things. We cannot just sedate ourselves. If you are in that kind of state, we call that you have rajoguna. You're completely active oriented. You yearn for action. You are attached to action. You also set goals, run behind that, work hard for that. This is all if you are. In most of the time, in most of the days, Vedic psychology will tell you that you have this attribute called rajas. It's called activity. Now, some people, they're very inert, very lazy, or they're also ignorant. They can't even understand what is happening around them. This is called tamas, tamoguna. This is your inertia. Now, inertia can be active or inertia can be passive. For example, in your team, sometimes you are supposed to stop acting and allow someone to act. This is a good thing to do. But when you are supposed to be in action, you are supposed to take the lead and you're not taking it, either because you don't know how to do that or you don't want to do that. This is called inertia. Now, those who are in depression, they are having this particular attribute more intense in them. They don't feel like doing first. Second, they don't understand their state. So ignorance is also part of tamas. Now, last, that is your sattva, that exactly what we all would love to have. That is illumination. clarity, knowledge of what is happening around me and around you. So this sattva, raja and tama, these three levers can make everything. Whatever that we do, you can classify in sattva, raja and tama. Sattva stands for knowledge, yearn for knowledge, clarity of thought, intelligence. This is all your sattva guna. Your raja guna is when you more active, when you feel like acting most of the time. For example, we call type A personality. Type A personality people, they always want to be in action. They set deadlines, for example. They try their level best to go for that. They're perfectionist. They cannot just sit quiet. Enterprising people. So that is Rajoguna. And as I said, Tamo means someone who is very inert, lethargic, ignorant, not understanding, making mistakes again and again. So this is three levers. We can get aware about that and we can also act accordingly. Okay, now I'm coming towards the end of this. As I told you in my previous slides, Western psychology works on dichotomy, you know, black, white, right, wrong, pain, pleasure. And they don't unify it, human experience. They classify it. On the contrary, the Vedic psychology is a science of human experience. We call that Sachidananda. The complete experience where there's no multiplicity. And I've written one line here. According to Vedic science, expansion means ananda. When you move from A to B, when you feel like you're growing in your either your academics or in your work life or in your family life or your personal life. When you say that the way I was and the way I am, I have grown. So expansion means ananda. And whenever you feel like you're not growing, you are limited, either because of your physical condition or either because of your psychological condition, we call that dukkha. So others are just words. And now you can see easily, failure in examination is actually not the cause of dukkha. Why you're not feeling okay? Because you're not growing. You're stuck, you're glued. That's what contraction means. Like you're not allowing oneself to go beyond the previous state. That's called dukkha. So expansion, always growing. So for example, one would get ananda in expanding economically. One would find ananda in expansion of wisdom. One would find ananda in creating more artistic forms. So you need to reflect where you feel like expanding. That's why they never stop. They keep on adding. Person who's already like very rich, people can ask why you still want to get money. So in that case, you feel like why that person is earning money? Because that person is finding expansion in that. So that's one thing. Then chit is your actual manifestation, your behavior that you show. And sat is your awareness, like thought and sensation. This is the complete experience of sat, chit, ananda. That's the entire human experience, unification of all three, always present. That's what the Vedic psychological basic human model is. And last is where that experience comes at five levels. First, that is your annamaya kosha, that is your gross physiological form, like your body, human. That is your annamaya. Then, pranamaya layer, you take the experience. Pranamaya is your basic need and quest to survive. You just maintain the form in pranamaya. Your impulse come into this. So body is your grossest form. Then your pranamaya, that is your sustenance of that form. Next is your monomaya. In monomaya, you have ideas and you also include others. In pranamaya, you don't include people actually. You want to sustain the way you are. Once you fulfill that experience, so where I formed my body, I formed what I want. After that, I have sustained that. Now I will include others also. So I, as you can see, I'm growing step by step. I'm including people inside. So that is manomaya, where my thoughts are there, feelings are there. Other people are there. I think about them. I either love them or I work for them. That is your manomaya. After that, you even think about what you did. That's called vijnanamaya, where your buddhi comes into picture, where you discern right, wrong, or eternal, or temporary, and how should I grow even further. So that is your next level understanding called vijnanamaya. So sophistication is going up, and understanding is also very deep. So I started from my existence, where attributes are there. Then I move to the pranamaya, where I have sustained it. Now I am including others. My ideas are expanding. Now one more expansion where I can make it stable. And last is where that what I am. Like in Western psychology, there's one person called Maslow who talked about self-actualization. Anandamaya is more than that, of course. It is like attributeless. When you are away from the fluctuations of emotions, you are the original state. So that's what Anandamaya is. So experience comes from this. Let me just go back to that. This bhava rasa, this antakkarana is a mechanism to make the entire process. These three levers which can create things for you. This is the total human experience. At five levels, you get this experience from basic to supreme. So, somebody said I had to. Piyusha, okay. Yes, it's the only glimpses I could give in 1 hour. Okay, so Annamaya is your form, body. If I say in simple words, it's your body. All of us, we have this body, you know, made up of food. How you will expand if you don't have the base body? So Annamaya Kosha talks about that. I'll give you a popular example. If you know about eating disorder, there's one eating disorder called anorexia nervosa, in which people, they feel like they're so fat, they don't look good. So they completely shrink their body, though they don't eat at all. Why? Because they feel body is what they are. Second example, people, those are not happy with their body image. Right now, this is like booming everywhere. People either joining gym or they're doing some horrible diet just to look good. If I put in a simple word, they are completely identified with their form, basic form. That is Annamaya. Once you sustain, when you form your body, then you sustain it. That is your pranamaya. So there are like different layers of your experience. In yoga and meditation, solution for all our difficult emotions? Yes, we have. There's a different sector altogether. The chitta vrittis are there and chitta bhumis are there. In yoga, we can have control over that.
I have a oral question.
Yes.
You said about the three levers related to rajas, tamas and sattva. And clearly your portrayal of rajas as activity prone and sometimes can be overactive because of that. Yes. And sattva as being balanced clearly with a good awareness, which allows the other levers to be, I guess, controlled correctly.
Yes.
Now, is there a use for the tamas lever at all, or it should be shut off? That's the question.
No, very much in use. Very much, Arjun. I'll give you one example. Tamoguna is also, as I said, active and passive. You know this Dahi Handi Utsav, when people, they make a human tower and they break.
Yes, yes.
Now, imagine if the base layer, is very rajasic, what will happen?
Okay.
If they start moving, they should surrender. So, and you can understand this, three are no good and bad. That's the beauty of this whole.
So, no. So what you're explaining is that the tama is not lack of energy, but no. It is not it is like in lack of patience. Rajasic is lack of patience, whereas tamasic, yes, can be over patience.
But now the problem with patience and inactivity, there's a difference. I would say patience is more in your sattva. When you know that this action or this endeavor is going to take, let's say, 2 years. So I should be clear about that. That is more sattva. As I said, clarity of thought is sattva. And okay, tamo guna is something when you surrender. Problem with tama is when you're supposed to be a rajasic person and you're taking backseat, then what will happen? Nothing will happen. That's why tamo guna, sattva guna and rajo guna, according to your demand, you should be able to control it. And you can do that with practice. Yoga is one of them. But before you, as I said, before you control it, you should understand it, your own prakriti. We call that mano prakriti. That's why sometimes we say, why can't you understand? Why? Because my tamoguna is so high. Or my rajoguna is also very high. That's why I cannot concentrate what you are actually talking about. So we are mixed. Yes, Rick, someone is Rick. We are mixture of all. And we can only control our psychological states when we control these three. So how to increase concentration? Okay, this is, I think, not part of this particular talk, because then I have to start talking about yoga. And there are other steps to be taken. So self-awareness, if you really want to know who you are, I would say you figure out your sattva rajatama. If you want to read more about that, I would recommend Bhagavad Gita chapter number 14, where you'll find a description of each guna. Now look, this nuance understanding is not available in Western psychology. They don't talk about these three sophisticated layers of experience and levers of experience. Once you get it, you can control it. Once you measure it, you can control it.
Thank you, sir.
I have a question.
Yeah.
So it looks like the three gunas need to be, they're all of them have their own role, and yes, we need to have them in the right proportion based on what we are trying to do, where, who we are, etc.
Mm-hmm.
So is it also possible that, for example, I think tamas is required for rest and rejuvenation. If there's zero tamas, then you'll always be in a state of hyperactivity.
Mm-hmm.
You not get rest and rejuvenation. Mm-hmm. Not able to sleep.
Yes, well. Yes.
So similarly, is it possible that there can be excess of sattva and that can also be harmful?
Yes. There is one shloka in Bhagavad Gita which talks about the problem with sattva is, if you're always yearn for knowledge, then you actually don't get along with people. Those are not knowledgeable. They get put off completely.
So you can go into solitude and be okay with it.
Yes.
To the point that you become a complete loner.
Correct.
Okay.
Someone who is not talking about clarity, you cannot stand.
Okay.
Sukha sukha sangena badnati jnana sange chanaka. That's like one line in Bhagavad Gita. It talks about you are so, self-indulgent in knowledge. That's what you know. That's why most of those are scientists. They feel alone.
Yes.
That's one of the reasons. Very good question. Okay, what is the difference between antakrana and sattva? Nah, very interesting. Now look at this. Antakrana, it's an instrument. I say karana means instrument. Upakarana, no? One word we use in Hindi or in Sanskrit, upakarana. Your mana, buddhi, chitta, ahankar. Which guna you attach to antakarana will define what is the actual software you have. So there is a difference, of course. Yeah, good sir. Book. Someone
one
has
question.
Raised hand. Yeah, yeah.
One question I have.
Yes, yes, yes.
Panch kosha. Mm-hmm. Panch kosh ki tarah se panch dosh bhi hote hain.
Panch dosh.
Dosha.
Sir, can you give me example, Panchadosha?
In Ayurveda, there are three
doshas. In kosh ke hi apne dosh hote hain kya? Wo maine suna hai.
Sir, pancha dosh nahi hote, dosh teen hote hain. Kapha, vata, pitta. वो तीन दोष होते हैं
उनका इन पांचों कोष से कोई लेना देना नहीं
जरूर जरूर है जरूर जैसे मैंने बोला कि ये एक कंबाइन एक्सपीरियंस होता है वो अलग ही टॉपिक है कि दोनों में कैसे इंटरेक्शन होता है सत्व रज तम कफ वात पित्त ये जब इंटरैक्ट करते हैं तो आपके पूरे पंचकोष में भी उसका इम्पैक्ट होता है
इम्पैक्ट होता है
जरूर होता है साइकोलॉजी
okay, वो कुछ एक तो तीन तो प्योर दोष होते हैं अलग वात पित्त एंड कफ और इनके मिक्स भी होते हैं तो टोटल मिला के पांच बनते हैं क्या
नहीं सर ऐसा नहीं है उनमें और बहुत सारे कॉम्बिनेशन होते हैं और जब त्रिगुण और त्रिदोष दोनों मिल जाते हैं तो और भी कॉम्बिनेशन होते हैं इतना सटल भी चेंज उसमें होता है अब जितना डीप जाओगे आपको पता चलेगा
नहीं एक कहीं सर्प दोष बात की जैसी चीज भी मैंने सुनी है
हाँ सर वो अलग है वो इसमें अच्छा, नहीं है वो उसका इस टॉपिक में नहीं है
उसका इस हेल्थ से कुछ लेना देना नहीं है
मैं इसके बारे में नहीं बता सकता वो अलग ही टॉपिक है जो इसमें नहीं आता
तो दिस इज रिलेटेड टू द हेल्थ
यस
ये पांच कोष भी पांचों कोष भी और वो तीन दोष
हम सब में ये सब जो मैंने अभी आपको आप सबको जो मैंने बताया है हम सब में ये सब होता है लेकिन हमको पता नहीं होता कितना क्या है
एक दूसरे को इफेक्ट करते हैं
Sir, can manas prakriti of the person can be changed by experience? Yes, of course. Yoga is the mechanism for that. Yoga is not, yoga asana only. It's a mechanism to correct this. Even aesthetics is also, it's a huge topic. That's why someone definitely, maybe wanted more from Vedic psychology. Like 1 hour is not good enough to talk about it. So I'll just introduce today. What are the like key concepts? How can we use these techniques of Vedic philosophy in our life? Atharva, if I say that in depression, for example, if you can understand why you actually misuse person who got into depression, one of the reason for depression is over achievement can be one particular reason and not accepting the fact that you cannot be rajasic every time. Lack of sattva, lack of understanding is also one of the prominent reason why someone gets into depression. It's not about breakup. It's not about losing job. It's about how you look at the whole thing. There's one thing. It's very important. So how you can use Vedic philosophy, Vedic psychology is first and foremost, I would say knowing your systems. Were you high on manas every time? Depressed people, they are very high on manas and smriti, chitta, thinking continuously about where they actually went wrong and not thinking about where they could succeed and not using intelligence. Now, why they don't use intelligence? There are biological reasons also because of neurotransmitters and other whatnot. There's one particular reason. So I would recommend all of you, if you really want to use some concepts, I completely understand 1 hour is not good enough to do this. But if you can figure out what type of guna prakriti you have. Yes, Abhishek, I'll give you. I'll give you this. Let me finish this answer and we'll suggest. So that is what type of guna prakriti you have, mano prakriti you have. That is first realization you can have. One inquiry you can have. Second, mana buddhi chitta ahankar, where you spend most of your time and energy. Are you living in the past kind of a person? Are you always on intelligence? Or you always talk about your ego? So that kind of analysis you can give to yourself. Abhishek, there is no one particular book as such for Vedic sciences. I would recommend you can start reading Bhagavad Gita. There's one. And if you want to know, I would recommend you refer to Ramakrishna Math books to start with, but there is no book as such. We are in the process. Okay, I'll take last maybe 2-3 questions. Raghudev, in psych, when we say yoga, is chitta vritti nirodha? Does it mean stoppage of only chitta vrittis or all including 4 facets? Okay, chitta vritti nirodha means vritti which are klishta, means vrittis which can lead to contraction, vrittis which can limit you. We want to get those vrittis cessated. Not all vrittis. There are good vrittis also. Because if you just stop your mind, then what? Meditation and concentration. Okay, there are different answers actually, Donal. One particular answer in yoga means when you are in top of your concentration is meditation. When you meditate upon, if you go to the Gayatri Mantra, Om Bhur Bhuvasvaha Tatsa Vitur Varenyam Bhargo Devasya Dhimahi Dhiyo Yona Prachodaya. I meditate upon. And people usually talk about meditation means they want to have like, you know, blank mind. You know, nirvikalpa. There is not even a single thought. It's very difficult to attain. I would not discourage you. Try. But actual meditation means thinking about very limited thoughts which can lead you to some good state.
Dhyan.
So, dhyan and dharana.
Hmm.
So, concentration, acute concentration, you know, niruddha, one concept in yoga, and samadhi.
Hmm.
So, if you continuously want to be blank, then you'll get more frustrated because mind's tendencies to go here and there, wavering.
आजकल डिप्रेशन का एक बड़ा टिपिकल केस सुशांत वाला चल रहा है।
हाँ, हाँ सर।
तो उसमें क्या-क्या फैक्टर्स एक्सप्ले कर रहे होंगे?
सर, मैं इसके बारे में आंसर तो दे सकता हूँ, लेकिन हमारे पास जो डेटा अवेलेबल है
उसके पास अच्छी खासी अर्निंग रही है।
हाँ।
उसके पास फेम भी रहा है।
हाँ।
नेम, फेम, मनी, सब कुछ।
सब था। सर मैं आंसर तो दे सकता हूँ, लेकिन मेरा प्रॉब्लम यह है कि जो हमारे पास इंफॉर्मेशन है मीडिया ने दी हुई है, तो कितनी ऑथेंटिक है मुझको ये नहीं पता। तो मैं सुशांत के बारे में बात नहीं कर सकता फुल,
कह नहीं सकते कि डिप्रेशन था भी या नहीं।
लेकिन मैं एक चीज आपको बता सकता हूँ कि सुशांत को आप थोड़ा बाजू में रखिए कि उसके साथ फेम था, लेकिन किसने हम कैसे श्योर कर सकते हैं कि फेम और पैसा ही उसको चाहिए था? जैसे मैंने एक आपको एक कॉन्सेप्ट दिया आप सबको कि कॉन्ट्रैक्शन एंड एक्सपांशन। इफ ही फेल्ट कॉन्ट्रैक्टेड समवेयर एंड लैक ऑफ इंटेलिजेंस इज वन ऑफ द रीजन फॉर ऑल प्रेडिकमेंट्स, नॉट ओनली सुसाइड, इवन सिंपल हर्ट दैट वी ऑल हैव, एंग्जायटी। नाउ एज आई सेड, व्हाट एंग्जायटी मींस, अप्रिहेंशन अबाउट फ्यूचर। नाउ लेट मी जस्ट टेक द लास्ट क्वेश्चन एंड आई आंसर दिस एंड देन आई लास्ट क्वेश्चन। व्हाट हैपेंस इन एंग्जायटी? व्हाट इफ this what if dialogue starts? What if I don't get success? Okay, you should ask this question: what do you mean by success? Validation by others? No, I need more money. Why do you need money? Okay, money can buy things. Okay, why you need those things? Okay, that things will make my life pleasurable. What do you mean by pleasurable? So you have to keep on asking these questions.
Yes.
Then you'll come to know. That's why I said buddhi means viveka. Something that is eternal, something that is perishable. So I would not say ki aap sab sant mahatma ban jaye aur sab chhod de. That's not the actual thing.
So vivek is something higher than the intelligence.
So IQ, we should not encourage only IQ.
EQ also.
EQ, IQ, and now people have coined SQ also. That is spiritual quotient.
Spiritual quotient.
So what do you mean by spiritual quotient? When you do such analysis, okay, my gunas are this, my antakkarana is not working properly. I either work more on memory or I work less on intelligence. This is the contribution to Western psychology. Western psychology doesn't even talk about this discernment or levels of experience. My body is not me. I'm just, body is part of me, or mind is just part of me. I am not my mind. We call the triputi, like if you want to change something, you should be away from that. Then only you can look at something. Otherwise you become that, and then there's a problem.
Is there something like social quotient also?
They call that, but these are not very academic terms. Two academic terms we use mostly, EQ and IQ. Social quotient is also combination of IQ and EQ only.
Okay.
Sir, one question was in the chat which got left behind. Is, okay. How is genetics connected with all this? Does it have a role? Somebody.
Yes, yes. So genetic, if you go to the Vedic psychology aspect of it, we also believe the time is circular in Vedic. We don't have this Western calendar that we follow. So you do carry your samskaras from previous birth. But today, this is not the topic. And I'm also not an expert on birth and rebirth. So I don't want to give any answer to this. But genetics is your body. So Annamaya is what? Annamaya has genetic component to it. So two sides are there. A soft side of human and hard side of human. Epigenetic and subtle part of it. You can see Annamaya is grossest. You can touch body. Prana, you can feel. But little bit on subtle side. After that, you tell me what you can actually touch. Can you touch your feeling? Can you touch your intellect? Can you touch your happiness? No, you cannot. So you just experience it at graded level. How can we use these teachings of Vedic philosophy in our life? I think I have answered this. Okay. So I think we should end this. Thank you for inviting me and giving me a chance to present my thoughts. If I haven't done justice to some questions, I beg your pardon.
Time hey, genetic. Hello.
Hello. Yes.
Genetic memory khali body mein aati hai aapke means hardware part of the human machine. And what about mind?
So mind is an abstraction. I said it's a function.
Mind is the function.
Yes. Mind is function.
So
it's a functional organ.
Programming.
Brain has got the memory.
Yes, you can say that. Hardware is one part of it. Yes, you can say that. Like for example, hippocampus. Please mute yourself.
Brain takes the birth with past life memories.
Yes, this is what our belief is. That's where the whole dispute starts, no? Whether it is proof, can you prove that? Can you, can you show me that? So you can say, okay, yeah, sure. Thank you all then. I take your leave. Thank you. Namaste.
Excellent, sir. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Dhanyavada.
Thank you very, very much, sir. Bahut badhiya session. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm ending the meeting.
Thank you very much, sir.